大家好，我是斐奇。在今天的访谈里，Dr. Stemler 将会来和我们谈谈什么是会说。认识 Dr. Stemler 是在 Colorado 的赛事大会上，他是一位会说治疗师，拥有超心理学的博士学位。当时 Dr. Stemler 的演讲《Multidimensional Self》多重次元的自己，带给我非常深刻的印象。他把每一个转世看成是多重次元的自己的不同面相，并且是现在的自己可以去连接的。在接下来的回溯练习里，他也让我感受到了我们的内在有一个更深的次元是跨越时空的，并且有一个内在的智慧比我们向来熟悉的自我要大得多。当时的我就有一个想法，希望能把这些有趣的观点和经验分享出去，让更多人知道，所以就有了这一次的访谈。在今天这个单元里，让我们来听听什么是回溯。Thanks for being here, Dr. Stemler. To get started, do you mind telling us about your background and how you get into past life regression?
Sure, I'd be glad to do that, Fai Chi. So I think my background or my interest in psychology started the way it starts for a lot of people, and that is I wanted to understand myself. And in understanding myself, I also wanted to understand life. The two were tied together. And so I've had some turbulence in my life, very early in my life. In that I was born in Poland during World War II. And my mother had to flee the Russians coming into Poland. And ultimately, our family came to this country as refugees in 1952. So, in my psyche, is a period of time that had a lot of want, like hunger, had fear and danger, very real fear and danger. And also there was a transition of cultures between a European and my background and my family is somewhat fundamentalist and religious orientation, to coming to this country and studying psychology and learning that what it takes to be a whole self. So that got me interested in psychology, and then of course, like every psych major, you find out that after 4 years, all you're qualified to do is sell encyclopedias. And nowadays, with the internet, you can't even do that. So I entered into a master's program in general psychology, and then started a PhD, but didn't complete it. Because that was the era of the Vietnam draft, I ended up going into the Air Force and was a pilot for some years. And when that finished, I said, okay, it's time to get back to the inner self and psychology. And I started reading a bunch of new age books. I was curious about what hypnosis was, so I took a weekend course in hypnotherapy. And when I felt like I understood that, I learned about past life regression, and that could be folded under transpersonal psychology. And back when I initially entered the PhD program, there was no transpersonal psychology. That's a latecomer. And the psychology I did learn in the 60s was behaviorism, which was a very materialistic orientation of the self, and sort of made the mistake. It said the only thing you can study is behavior, because it wanted to be desperately to be scientific. But the mistake I think that that discipline made was it therefore concluded nothing else exists. So the whole inner self, the whole wisdom traditions, that was thrown out the window, at least in my viewpoint. Transpersonal psychology brings that all back. So shamanism, the internal self, internal reality, Buddhist thought, all of that came back into play. So as a part of learning the straight hypnosis process, which we can talk about in a minute, I heard about going to other lives, so-called past life regression. And that interested me. And I found a mentor and did a 2-year training program to do that. And what I discovered was the deeper you got into it, the greater the multidimensional self emerged, and we can talk about that as well. And there really was no end to the self. So what Alan Watts calls the skin-encapsulated self, which is the way the ego views itself, was there was just huge world, as a matter of fact, a universe, maybe multiple universes, of the self that existed. And so that's my fascination with transpersonal psychology and also this kind of regression.
It is an amazing journey that you have come through. Now, can you tell us more about what past life regression is and how it works?
Regression hinges, and so does hypnosis, and I'll tell the difference. But regression hinges on what's called dissociation. So dissociation is when you step outside of either self or time. You dissociate when you daydream. You're driving down a road, you know, for 10 miles, and suddenly you realize you hadn't noticed anything that was on the road because you were sort of lost in your mind. Your driving was automatic. Some people fish because, in essence, that triggers dissociation. Their mind is freed because of the rhythmic activity they're doing, and they travel in terms of daydreams. So dissociation is an important part both in hypnosis and in regression. Hypnosis dissociates to refine your focus on the suggestions that the hypnotherapist is giving you. So there may be suggestions couched in symbolic terms or in actual suggestions like, I no longer desire to smoke. So if you have a smoking habit, or you want to cut down on the food that you eat, hypnotic suggestions, because they're deeply focused, can have quite a profound effect if done correctly. A past life regressionist takes that one step further and allows the dissociation, that is dropping away time and space that you're at in the present moment, to explore other aspects of yourself. Psychology has used regression ever since Freud's day, and that it was used as a this life, a present life suggestion to go back to childhood to find the beginning of a problem that you've got in adults, a neuroses or a compulsion or something like that. And typically those do start in some place in childhood, and the child, with its world limited to its parent or limited to the mother, concludes, this is my world, and if something traumatic happens, develops a strategy towards life, and that strategy is continued in adulthood. And since the adult experience may not be the same as childhood, it becomes an ineffective, maybe even painful strategy for dealing with whatever that was. So psychoanalysts, I think counselors nowadays don't tend not to do that so much, but traditionally used hypnosis, which is a form of relaxation and focus, to get the client back into childhood and find out where did the problem start. Now, as Brian Weiss so beautifully discovered in his book, Many Lives, Many Masters, occasionally, and this has happened to more than one psychoanalytic professional, they would get frustrated and not be able to find the source of the problem, and then say to the client, go back to where this problem started, and be shocked to find that the client is in a so-called past life. Mm-hmm. And of course, Brian Weiss now has written several books, and there have been converts to the whole business of past life regression based on that kind of experience. So dissociation is the key, and dissociation in a very simple terms is just getting outside of where you are in terms of the self and the time that you're in to allow your mind to go to another place. Mm-hmm. In this life regression, you go to childhood typically. In past life regression, you go to so-called past life. to discover what you need to know there. And for a psychoanalyst, what you need to know is what happened that caused you to have this problem in this present life.
Okay, along the same logic that the regression process can bring back a wound that occurred in the past, could a past life regression inadvertently bring up a past wound that would otherwise not be there?
So that's a great question, and that's a common perception. So the process for doing doing therapy of this kind is the client. You have to back up and you have to say, okay, so the client comes in and says, I've got this problem with X, all right? Mm-hmm. So the problem might be that you always find the wrong kind of man. The problem might be that you fear authority. The problem might be any number of things, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why do I have a reluctance to do X? I have this burning drive to write a book, mm-hmm. and I can't get myself to do it. What's the problem? And for a past life regressionist, you either implicitly or explicitly develop a regression question. So the regression question is, what's the root cause of my problem with male energy? Or what's the root cause of my problem that I don't have sympathy? Any number of those things. And what happens is the unconscious goes to those lives that answer that question. So virtually all of us have any number of lives. In some views, we each have infinite number of lives. However, with a regression question, again, it explicitly or implicitly, the unconscious responds to that by giving you the lives that are associated with that issue. And so, and very often that does represent some kind of trauma. That's why it's an issue. That's why it was brought into the current life. And by having that issue come up, the therapist can then resolve it, take away the traumatic energy that's associated with it. And by understanding, so Brian Weiss says that, he says any regression is a good regression because he feels when you get that understanding, the current problem that you're dealing with can then disappear. And often it does. So you don't go to the past life to get a trauma that you then have no control over. You go to the past life to find a trauma to a specific question, which then gives you the opportunity to resolve the problem that is described in that question. So other lives often occur spontaneously. Sometimes young children spontaneously will remember their, quote, previous life, unquote, which was demonstrated in the research by Ian Stevenson at the University of Virginia. Sometimes you run into and have exchanges with a past life in a dream state, and sometimes that occurs in other altered states of consciousness. So even under a condition of smoking marijuana or some other psychotropic drug, this material will come up. Now, you may not recognize what it is, but through the therapy and going to that life, you can say, ah, yes, that was the connection in the dream state. Mm-hmm. So for even regular people that don't go to therapy, they will often have this interchange with their other lives. Usually it's working a problem that they're working.
So what you're saying is sometimes even unknowingly, we've been connecting with our past life. However, many people still question it, though, so could you talk about how it is even possible?
Okay, so there's an issue here of worldview. So if your worldview is one of materialism and the materialist reality is all that you have, and with that comes the Newtonian Cartesian idea of linear time and a material reality that has a very logical effect in terms of the laws, the conventional laws of physics, then you'll have trouble understanding the fact that even there is reincarnation or there are other lives, no matter how you couch it, you'll have a problem with that concept. In terms of physics, there's research out there that shows, if not proves, that the mind is non-local, meaning that the mind is not limited to a Newtonian view of reality, where material things impact other material things, and that's the only way it can be. So the research there that was done was research into remote viewing, and this was done by the CIA, by the government. What's available public is that they spent publicly is that they spent $27 million on that research. I suspect it's much more than that, and led to, at that time, a number of highly classified programs to use that approach. So what happened was, there was information that the Russians had engaged in this kind of research, and our belief in it was that couldn't possibly be true, but if it is, we sure need to know about it. So there are two researchers, Russell Targ and Harold Puthoff, both laser physicists, who were asked to do this research, and I won't go into why. There's history available on that. And they devised some experiments that in the final analysis showed that this process can be done highly effectively. Now, the protocol they came up with, the scientific protocol they came up with, really, one, the first step is dissociation. So they call that the cool down phase. And just like you would do in hypnotherapy or hypnosis, they use their own techniques, but that's what it did. So that you transcended your current position in space and time with the mind. And then the protocols very carefully created the condition where the analytical left brain, for as long as possible, was kept out of it. So as you find with a lot of psychic kinds of activities, they tend to occur more in the right brain, typically. Mm-hmm. And what they found out was that mentally they could access information anywhere in space and time. So they could access information on Jupiter and foresee what one of our Vanguard space probes was going to see when they flew by. Or typically in the intelligence community, and this is public documented in books and stuff, and this is published in scientific journals, they would be given, the remote viewers would be given either a latitude, longitude, and the question is what's there, and they would very accurately describe what is there. Not only the physical component, but the psychological component as well. Mm-hmm. Or they might be given the latitude, longitude of a satellite picture taken overhead and say, there's a big structure, tell me what's inside it. Mm-hmm. And the remote viewer would look inside the structure mentally and describe what was going on. And they could even describe the thinking that individuals that were, for example, in charge of that program were thinking about. So there's a couple of famous examples of that. I won't go into that. But what that proves to me, that whole program, and again, to underscore this, the conclusion is from the experiments that it doesn't matter how far away the location is that you want to know information about, it does not reduce the ability to get the information, and it does not matter where in time it is. So it can be ancient time and you can get information, or it can be future time and you can get information. So that tells you two things. One is that mind is non-local, that can travel. So in so-called past life regressions, you're traveling to other selves in space and time. And the other thing it shows, and we'll talk about this in one of our sessions, is the quantum mechanical aspect of physics, which says that time is simultaneous. So the past and the future and alternate presence are all possible to be researched by the mind, and can be researched by a so-called past life regression. Mm-hmm. Of course, then it isn't past life anymore. It can be future life, which we call progression. So under the old Newtonian rules, that's not possible. Under the new rules of quantum mechanics, not only is it possible, it's quite easy. In my experience, my clients have no problem doing that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so when you're in a remote viewing or regression session, how do you know what you see is real or something you imagine?
So most often, the only way you know that it's real is the nature of the experience that you have. In most of these experiences, the experience is so intense that it forces you to conclude that it was real in some fashion. Now, for those people who have problems, either because of religion, cultural conditioning, or whatever, materialistic scientific worldview, that have problems with believing that in reincarnation, for example, the process in terms of therapy works just as well. And what the individual is encouraged to believe then is that simply that the unconscious is vast, and the unconscious will create experiences for healing. And you don't have to answer the question, is it a real regression or isn't it? Mm-hmm. But it's quite easy to tell whether it's fantasy or not. Mm-hmm. And very often, a therapist will encourage you, you know, at first you fake it, and then you make it. So you're almost encouraged to fantasize, and pretty soon you're in the real thing. Mm-hmm. Some lives you can actually research, and there's been some wonderful books. Maybe we can give them my website. I've got an extensive reading list that has some examples of that. Some mm-hmm. wonderful books where people have taken painstaking research, including Ian Stevenson's work, and show that in specific instances, there's a really high probability that this is real. So I had a lady as a client the other day, mm-hmm. who had a regression question that carried her to a life in Asia, and the family that she had was Asian, and she couldn't understand why she looked European, blonde and blue-eyed, and her parents were Asian. And what she discovered as she went along in the regression was that she was part of the process of the Huns when they attacked into Europe. They would take children that they found interesting, and certainly blue-eyed blonde children for an Asian would be an interesting, you know, mm-hmm. interesting person, and they would take the children back to have them raised. And I asked her what period of time was this, and without hesitation, she said 1310. Mm-hmm. Well, after the regression, she researched whether that was even possible, and that was a time period when that occurred. So there's sometimes, if the life is more recent or famous, you can do some actual historical research. But in terms of that particular regression, at least you can say, well, historically it could fit. Mm-hmm. And that satisfied her.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that makes sense.
Yeah. For most people, once they get into it, they make a subjective call on whether it's real or not. And given what it does for them in terms of information, clearing a problem, it becomes irrelevant. Uh-huh. Yeah. So by the way, there's a lady called Helen Wambach, who's long since been deceased, mm-hmm. who wanted to address this business. There was a bias among people, as there is sometimes today. One, that it's fantasy, and two, they're all famous lives, so it can't possibly be real. And so she wanted to address both of those things and did research largely in the 70s. and she would regress hundreds and hundreds of people. Then afterwards, she would give them a questionnaire. And she's written two books. So Wambach is W-A-M-B-A-C-H, I believe is the way she spells her name. Mm-hmm. And they're still available. And so she published the research. And what the research showed was the experience of the people mimicked what we know historically. So, for example, if you're going to fantasize an American Indian, you're going to have four or five tribes, you know, Apache, mm-hmm. Navajo, Hopi, that are popular in movies. And that's probably what you're going to fantasize. But the reality is there's like some 360 different tribes in North and South America. And if you're going to be claim that it's not fantasy, then you'd want representation, statistical representation of these other tribes. And that's exactly what she found. She found that what these people were experiencing in the Middle Ages, for example, was the ratios of, you know, of the burgeoning, of the coming middle class, the shop owners versus serfs versus the noblemen. Those were in proportion to what you would expect to find historically. Mm-hmm. So it was an interesting bit of research that didn't prove reincarnation or the veracity of past lives. But it did show that it's more than fantasy and it's more than just famous lives. Mm-hmm. And I know from my own experience, famous lives almost never come up.
Mm-hmm. One last question I have is, throughout your clinical practice, are there any other surprises or further insights that you would like to share with us?
So I think what happens, the surprises are, as you work with the material, the expansion of your worldview. Mm-hmm. What happens is that your idea of the self, to put it mildly, gets expanded to the level of the universe. And I mean that literally. And we'll talk about that in quantum mechanics a little bit. Mm-hmm. But so that's the big surprise, and the fact that, so I'll just give a hint. I don't want to go into a lot right now. We will in another mm-hmm. segment.
Okay.
But the hint that the self is not just a human self, mm-hmm. that the self goes well beyond that, mm-hmm. And allows for other experiences, and so that's the fascinating part.
So in a sense, we are really much larger than the self we currently know.
That's right. Yeah, mm-hmm. we're more than the physical self that we know, certainly more than the ego. The ego is really the smaller part of us, although the ego thinks it's in charge. Mm-hmm. So I hinted at it a little bit earlier, and part of the self, there's a concept in physics, comes out of quantum mechanics, but it comes also out of other aspects of physics, of simultaneous time. And what it says is, and even Einstein made mention of this, is that the mind creates linear time to make sense of things. But really outside of the mind, time is simultaneous. That is, the past, the present, and the future all coexist. And if that's true, then we ought to be able to progress rather than regress. So progression is going forward in time, and my clients do that regularly. And so that what this doesn't say, and again, we'll discuss this another time, but what doesn't say is the future, because you can see it, experience it, mm-hmm. is not preordained, is not, what's the word I'm looking for? Fixed in stone.
Right. And,
but it is available. It mm-hmm. is available to you. Mm-hmm. And so that's another fascinating dimension of so-called past life regression, which mm-hmm. is other life.
Mm-hmm. Which means you can see into probabilities?
Well, that's the other part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which is the other part of it. And that's why it doesn't take free will away from you.
Mm-hmm.
You're seeing into probabilities. That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. And the progression in the field is not really that new. There were regressionists who routinely, and Brian Weiss wrote a book about this, but there are many others who routinely use a future life in order to heal the present life. As a matter of fact, there's a past life regressionist called Goldsmith is his name, and he wrote an article on maybe your problem came from the future and not the past. So he routinely used future lives as a way to heal therapeutically, which is fascinating.
How does he use the future self to heal the current self? Is it because the future self is more mature and complete?
Okay, so that's a linear view of reality, even if you are looking at the future. That is, there's this notion of progression.
Mm-hmm.
And in a non-linear view, you could just as easily go from the present life in the present modern day to going back to the pyramids.
Mm-hmm.
And be a part of building the pyramids.
Right.
So in that sense, there is no linear progression in that sense. There is an evolution of the self and an expansion of the self, but that evolution is not time-bound.
Mm-hmm.
So in Goldsmith's case, he had an individual that had certain anxieties, and when he progressed him into the future, he found out that he was a scientist working on a nuclear program, and because of his arrogance and his inability to bring others into the project, made a mistake and caused a nuclear explosion.
Mm-hmm.
And this affected his current life in terms of the work that he did in the current life. And when that future life, one, when that was found out, and two, and this gets a little deeper than what we probably want to talk about today, but mm-hmm. he paired that with a probable future life where he brought in the resources to deal with that, and that didn't happen.
Mm-hmm.
And when he did that, Goldsmith, with the client, his current problems, his current anxieties disappeared. So we'll make more sense of that in future discussions.
That sounds good. 接下来我们会在下一集的访谈里更详细的来谈量子力学观里的回溯。正在收看的大家，谢谢你们。